processes. You're gonna name the process for the bonus going toward. So here we've got the zygomatic process. Second, name the bone it's coming from of the temporal bone. It's meeting up with the temporal process of the zygomatic bone. So you know your rules and I point to a process. All you have to figure out is what is the bone it's a part of and what is it going towards. So of course, am I going to ask you about the zygomatic process of the temporal bone and the temporal process of the zygomatic bone? Of course, maybe not. I want you to see if you know how to use the rules. So we'll go over some of these. We got the temporal process of the zygomatic bone. We got also a process here on the zygomatic bone. What is that? How would you name it? Frontal process of the zygomatic bone, because it's going towards the frontal bone. That's number one rule, and then it's part of the zygomatic bone. We've got a little process there, and a little process there. So if you were going to name them, what would you name them? Okay. Superior maxillary process of the zygomatic bone and inferior maxillary process of the zygomatic bone. Okay, we've got a process there, the yellow one. What do you call that? Of the frontal bone. We have a process here in orange going towards the yellow, so that is the frontal process of the maxilla. Okay, so if you know your rules, number one, name the bone it's going towards, so frontal process, and then where is it coming from? Of maxillary bone. Okay. We also have a process here. That's the mastoid process. We've got another process there called the styloid process. Those two processes aren't going towards any other bone, they're just kind of sticking out. One is named for the fact that it looks like a needle. And if you know what a record player was, and you had these big black discs that are made out of vinyl, and you put a needle in the tracks on the record and it vibrated back and forth, you had music or speech or something else. So we had needles even before that. Way back, they had needles, and so anything that looked like a needle-like projection was called a styloid process. Let's see what else. Okay, we got the chin called the mental, it's called the mentis. So where the chin points out, it's called the mental protuberance. In the mental region, you have a foramen called the mental foramen. What's the muscle most likely going to be called that's attached to the mental protuberance? Not, you're thinking way too much. So if it's attached to the mentis, if it's in the mental region, how would you name that muscle?
Mentalis.
Up here you have a muscle attached to the frontal bone. Frontalis. You have a muscle that's working over the parietal area, you call it? parietalis, except you don't have a muscle there. All you have is connective tissue. So you have a muscle back here that's connected with connective tissue to the frontalis. So you can name, yes, front. So the whole structure is front, is occipital frontalis or frontal occipitalis. Okay, so you're catching on. You can name things for where they're located. Okay, this is just a summary of the bones that are forming the skull. So one occipital, one frontal, one sphenoid, one ethmoid, and then paired temporal, and two parietal. So you take the skull and you fill it up with sawdust that's been moistened, and you slowly heat up that sawdust so that the water starts expanding in the cells of the sawdust. All the joints of your skull just slowly pull apart, and you have individual bones of the skull. So they have a whole series of these in your textbook, and overall we call it the exploded skull. It's not really, you didn't set off C4 in the skull, because that would just make fragments, but slowly expand the sawdust, and then the skull just separates into individual bones. So this is your occipital bone from this exploded skull. Foramen magnum, largest foramen in the body, in your skeletal system. We also have a little channel there in the right lateral in the area of the foramen magnum. Could call it the hypoglossal foramen, but they chose to call it the hypoglossal canal. So it's named for one of the cranial nerves that's exiting the cranial vault at that point. Then we have a jugular notch on either side. Jugular, we have a jugular vein. The jugular foramen we're going to see on the intact skull, but it's formed half by the occipital bone and half by the temporal bone. So all we see on the occipital bone is half of the foramen. Looks like somebody went in there and notched out the bone. Actually, the two bones grew around the jugular vein and created a foramen. But all we see here on the occipital bone is the jugular notch. We have a groove for one of the sinuses that doesn't have anything to do with bone. This is a venous sinus that is collecting blood from your brain and happens to be in that position on the occipital bone. Scooped out areas in the inside of the bone, fossa. So we've got the fossa for your cerebellum. Cerebellum means little brain. And then we have the fossa for your cerebrum, the bigger part of your brain. Here's your internal occipital protuberance. Here's your external occipital protuberance. We have nuchal lines. We're going to find out when we get to joints that we have a nuchal ligament. Nuchal ligament is attaching to the occipital bone, and so when the weight of the head is pulling on this elastic ligament, then the force is transmitted to the bone and you get a line developing there. If there's an inferior, you better look for a superior, because you don't bother to say inferior if there's only one. So if you see superior, then look for an inferior. Condyles, remember those are smooth articular processes. The occipital condyle is where your head will rock on the first cervical vertebrae, your axis. So you look at the skull, you have a nice smooth articular surface there. Put the bones back together with the temporal bone. Now you have jugular foramen. So the jugular notch on the occipital bone is meeting up with a corresponding notch on the temporal bone and forming the foramen there. See the foramen magnum. We see the occipital condyles. See the external occipital protuberance and the nuchal lines. Carotid artery is smaller than the jugular vein. Veins tend to be storage vessels. Arterioles are going to want to get the blood out. Veins kind of care about getting the blood back to the heart, but they don't have a lot of smooth muscle, and so if the fluid collects, they just tend to expand. So they're a little bit floppier, a little bit bigger. Okay, this is probably one of the most boring bones in body. It's just the flat parietal bone. It's got a line on it for, got two lines on it for your temporalis muscle that when you, it's a muscle of mastication, so if you're eating a lot of tough meat all the time, chewing on a lot of carrots and celery, then, or if you're Cirque du Soleil and you got something in your mouth and you're whipping yourself around on this wire, then you've got really strong jaw muscles and you probably have very prominent temporal lines. But for most people, eating mostly mushy stuff and just not very much pore supply, it's very hard even to distinguish those two lines on the parietal bone. It's a little beveling on the surface of the parietal bone because the parietal bone actually goes under the flat part of the temporal bone. So they kind of form a beveled joint together. And there's, that's about it with the parietal bone. Not much to it. The frontal bone, you get a little bit more excitement when you look at it because there are other things attached. You got a frontal sinus. You've got a notch where the ethmoid bone is going to be, openings where the sinuses are going to be. You've got attachment for your meninges, and so when your head is sloshing around inside your skull, you get some forces applied to the inside of the skull via this fluid movement and brain matter movement. And so you get a frontal crest, ethmoid bone, where the dura mater is actually attached at a very specific point. You get a elevated, very sharp crest there, you'll see with the ethmoid bone. You also form the upper part of the orbit, and then there's an attachment for the nasal bones. So here you see a suture between the right and left halves of the frontal bone. This is a suture when it exists. In most skulls, it has completely ossified. No indication that there ever was a suture there. There always was a suture formed first, and then that sutural joint became completely ossified. And joined together by bone, we're gonna learn that's called a synostosis. So metoptic suture is only identified when it's there. It was there in everybody's skull, but it's also still there in this particular skull. We used to have a skull with a really prominent metoptic suture and somebody stole it. I don't know, it just disappeared from lab. It's been happening more and more lately. Things have been disappearing from lab. Okay, so forming part of the upper part of the orbit, also set up in this upper part of your orbit is your lacrimal gland, which produces the tears that cleanse and wash the surface of your eye. So where the gland is, there's a little additional scooped out area called a fossa. That supraorbital foramen and a supraorbital margin in the frontal bone. The frontal sinuses contain your respiratory epithelium. They'll have an opening where the mucus can come out into the nasal cavity. Temporal bone, very complex actually. You've got parts of it that are going to be forming by intramembranous ossification. That's the boring part. That's your squamous part. All the rest is going to develop via cartilage formation so that you can get the rest of these complexities. You get the zygomatic process. You get the external acoustic meatus. And then on the inside, you're going to have the internal acoustic meatus. You're going to have carotid artery going through the temporal bone at one point. You're going to have nerves going through the temporal bone to reach your vestibular apparatus and your cochlea to tell you about hearing and balance information. And those are going to run through the internal acoustic meatus and then split, and some of them are going to go through the stylomastoid foramen and head off to other structures. Mastoid process has a lot of little tiny sinuses in it. They're so small that they're just usually referred to as air cells. So little pockets, oops, pressed the wrong button. Little pockets of openings, and so they're referred to as air cells. They're not really cells at all, just little pockets in the bone. So external acoustic meatus is where sounds go in this tetrous portion of the temporal bone, here and here. That's where your delicate membranes of your cochlea and your vestibular apparatus will be located. Here the mastoid process has been dissected out, and you see the little tiny openings that are referred to as air cells. The mastoid foramen nerve is going to exit through there. Sphenoid bone. I told you it was irregular. It's very irregular. It's the most irregular of all the irregular bones. You've got two processes going downwards that will attach muscles. Muscles will be attached to that. The muscles are called pterygoid muscles, and so the process is named for them. It's called the pterygoid process. You've got two pterygoid muscles, a medial and a lateral, and you have two pterygoid processes, a medial and a lateral. So named for their location, medial pterygoid and then lateral pterygoid process. Up here, greater wing. So it actually looks like a bat wing or bird wing out there. And then lesser wings of the sphenoid bone. In the central area here, we've got at least two, sometimes more, sphenoidal sinuses. So again, the respiratory epithelium making mucus that will drain out into your nasal cavity. We have a foramen that is round, so it's called foramen rotundum. And then we look on the, look down on the sphenoid bone that to the inside of the skull, we see there is also an oval foramen. So foramen ovale. We have a foramen that is very small and spiny looking, so foramen spinosum. And then we have a jagged area there that will form a foramen with the occipital bone. So only on the intact skull we're going to see that foramen. This rounded area here is kind of scooped out. We don't call it a fossa. They looked at it from the side. Oops, passed it. And looked at it and said, that looks like a Turkish saddle. So you have to know the Middle East and know what kind of saddles these Turks ride in. And then you will see that the Turkish saddle, not the Western saddle, but a Turkish saddle, has this type of shape. So they call it the Sella Turcica, the saddle of the Turks. So it is a fossa, but they call it Sella Turcica. And then that is an identifying feature of the sphenoid bone. That's the Sella Turcica here. We also, if you look under these little protuberance called clinoid processes, we have a posterior and an anterior and also a middle clinoid process. If you look under them, you find more foramen and fissure. Okay, so lesser wing, greater wing of the sphenoid bone. Ethmoid bone, again, very complex and irregular in shape. When we looked at the first slide, all we saw was the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone from the side. That's forming the upper part of our nasal septum, partition between right and left nasal cavities. That vomer, which was unpaired, that was associated with the roof of the mouth, that's forming the lower bony part of our nasal septum. The rest of the nasal septum is just cartilage filling in the partition. So you can see most of the perpendicular plate here, some of the perpendicular plate from looking down above. What mostly you see from above are these tiny little openings in the bone lateral to the midline, and then the bigger openings that are your ethmoid air cells. So we have ethmoid air cells just like mastoid air cells, smaller little sinuses. These small little openings form what's called the cribriform plate. Cribriform means in the shape of, so in the form of cribri. Cribri, you look it up and the definition is sieve, S-I-E-V-E. What is a sieve? It is something that you put fluids and pasta through so that water goes through but the pasta is kept behind. You're trying to sieve juice, you're trying to catch the pulp or the seed so the juice is separated. So they looked at the bone and they said, looks like a sieve, and called it cribriform plate. It actually is where the nerves that go into your olfactory epithelium are going between the nasal cavity, the sensory nerves come up and join the olfactory bulb and then process at that point. Looking from the posterior view and also from the anterior view, there's a very characteristic crest in the midline. This is called the crista galli. That is where dura mater is attached to the ethmoid bone. So every time you say, the brain is sloshing around inside the fluid in the subarachnoid space, that is putting pressure on the dura mater. The dura mater is pulling on this crista galli, and the more compliant you are, the more yeses, then the higher this crista galli gets. You touch it, it could slice you. If you press hard on it, it would just cut your finger. If you're into martial arts and you are taught to stun your opponent, I'm not your opponent really, but you know, a foe, one of the things they teach is take the heel of your hand and shove it into the nasal cavity, which then drives the ethmoid bone and the crista galli into the individual's brain. So if you do that, you could kill them, but you could also just stun them and you have time to escape. So What's the purpose of the Christagalli? It's not to kill people. The purpose of the Christagalli is to anchor your dura mater to the bone. Happens to elevate and form this sharp crest, which you can then use as a deterrent to anybody who's trying to attack you. So put the ethmoid bone back into the skull. You see the Christagalli, this elevation, it's attached to the dura mater that will line the skull. And then you also see two processes that are acting to churn up the air that you inhale. You don't see it when you look, you don't see them very efficiently in these views. This smaller little projection and this projection are posterior and elevated superior. So if you're looking in the front of the nose, you don't even see these two particular processes. The fact that they're used as turbinates to churn up the air so that any particulate matter is then stuck in the mucus that is coming from all these air cells and sinuses, those are called concha. So you have a superior and a middle nasal concha. So you still have to seek out and find your inferior nasal concha. It is not part of the ethmoid bone. So you go to the next slide, and there's your inferior nasal concha. You look closely, it's attached to your maxilla. It's attached to some other bone here, and it's attached to another bone back here. So actually, it's attached to three bones. It's an individual bone all unto itself. So it's attached to the palatine bone, it's attached to the maxilla, and primarily to the maxilla and the palatine bone. So when you put all the bones together and look from above down into the cranial, they call it vault, I guess because it's containing all the valuable information up there. You got an anterior cranial fossa, two halves, middle cranial fossa, two, and then posterior cranial fossa. The anterior cranial fossa is primarily formed by the frontal bones, but also ethmoid and sphenoid. The frontal lobe will sit in that position. Middle cranial fossa is formed by sphenoid, temporal, and occipital bones, and that is going to be where your temporal lobe is located, and the posterior cranial fossa by the occipital bone. When you put all the dura mater back, all this white, shiny stuff, silvery, shiny stuff, that's dura mater. Attached to the Christagalli anteriorly, and then it's going to go in between all the major lobes of your brain. It's going to have nerves and arteries running through it. And this is your spinal, this is your brain stem right there. And then also going between the two sides of your cerebellum that are sitting in those areas. In the dura mater, you're going to have large sinuses, not bony sinuses, but venous sinuses that are collecting fluid from the brain matter that's sitting in those areas. So look, there is an anterior clinoid process. There is a posterior clinoid process. And there are also medial clinoid processes there. When you look underneath those processes, you're going to see the opening for your optic canal. It's best identified from the orbital side. Here you have to kind of look down underneath those processes to see this nice round foramen where the optic nerve is going to have been originally and then the bone formed around it. You have optic canal there, and come out, you have a round foramen up here, then an oval foramen, and then one that's called a lacerum, lacerated, jagged cut up, looks like a jagged edge cut out of the bone that actually had cartilage there, and the cartilage was removed, and so the bone looks like there's a foramen there, but actually nothing was actually going through it. Internal acoustic meatus, jugular foramen, hypoglossal canal, and foramen magnum. So every time you learn a new bone, come back to the intact skull and see if you can identify the features in the intact skull. Could be an individual bone that I'm using or the intact skull for identification. So facial bones, we've gone over these. Now let's go and look at the skull for the individual bones. So maxilla, we've got a frontal process. You already know how to name it, frontal process of the maxillary bone. We've got a zygomatic process of the maxillary bone. We've got alveolar processes. We didn't talk about alveoli, but alveoli are round, kind of grape-like structures. If you've had class in physiology and anatomy before, you know that round grape-like structures are in your lungs for gas exchange. They're also called alveoli. When you pull your teeth out and you look at the hole that's left in your skull, you have a round structure there, and that's called an alveolus as well. These processes that come down between your teeth are called alveolar processes. Looking at the inside of the maxilla, you see there's a huge maxillary sinus there. You can actually see through the bone into the maxillary sinus. This is very fragile bone here. If you fracture it, very hard to heal that because it fragments into all the tiny little pieces. So it's such a thin section of bone. Little groove where the maxilla and the lacrimal bone attach together. And then you on the inside, the hard palate is going back towards the palatine bone. So you've got another process forming the top, the hard palate. And that's your palatine process of your maxilla. The palatine bone forms the back of your hard palate. You take your tongue and start at the top teeth, and then run it over the top surface all the way back. Just before you start to gag, you run, it'll be hard, and then you'll hit a soft spot in the back. That's the end of your palatine bone when you get to the soft palate back there. So the upper portion of the hard palate is, wrong button. So formed by the palatine process. About two-thirds of that hard palate is the palatine process. The last third is the palatine bone. Palatine bone has a nasal crest in the center where the vomer is going to attach. The vomer is going to form the inferior part of your nasal septum. So the bottom part of your nasal septum is formed by the palatine bone. The lateral wall of your nasal cavity is formed by your palatine bone. And then there's a process up here called the orbital process. If you look at the inside of the orbit, there's a tiny little kind of triangular little patch in the base of your orbit that is from the palatine bone. Most of it is forming nasal cavity. Conchal crest means that inferior nasal concha is going to be attached to this palatine bone. This perpendicular plate here, it's not too perpendicular. Don't get it confused with the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone. Has nothing to do with the nasal septum. It's forming lateral walls of the nasal cavity. And then the ethmoid bone will be attached to a small portion of the palatine bone laterally. Look at the back of the orbit, that little bit here that sort of looks triangular when you look at it from this angle, but if you look down on it, it's more of a diamond shape. That is palatine bone. The rest of the back of your orbit is formed by facial and cranial bones. The very back is sphenoid bone. Sphenoid, he has a lot of nerves and vessels that are coming into the orbit, going through the sphenoid, or going through the area of the sphenoid bone formation. So the back, you're going to have a superior orbital fissure and an inferior orbital fissure. Those are chunks of area that already were taken up by nerves and arteries, so the bone had to form around them. So here you got superior orbital fissure and then inferior orbital fissure. In the back here, nice round foramen, but they call it a canal. And it's called the optic canal for the optic nerve. Medial wall of the orbit. Superior medial wall is frontal bone. Medial middle wall is ethmoid. And then inferior medial is maxilla. And then most of the inferior orbit is maxilla. Laterally, you start to get zygomatic involved. And then you come up to the top of the orbit again, and you've got the frontal bone. So what forms your orbit? Frontal bone, zygomatic bone, ethmoid bone, maxilla. And don't forget, well, sphenoid bone in the back, but don't forget palatine bone. The palatine bone is also there. So here's the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone. You don't see the nasal concha. Remove that perpendicular plate. You see the superior middle nasal concha. You see the inferior colored in blue to tell you it's not part of the maxilla, it's not part of your ethmoid bone, it's not part of your palatine bone, it's a bone all unto itself. So it's attached mostly to the maxilla and then to the palatine bone and a little bit to the ethmoid bone. These three concha, every time you inhale, they're going to churn up the air to humidify it, to warm it, and to clean it. So they're serving as your air conditioning system for the body. You inhale through your mouth, all the crud goes in at the same time. But if you inhale through your nose, you have a chance to clean it, humidify it, and also warm it. All the frontal sinuses drain into the nasal cavity. So sphenoid, ethmoid, the maxillary sinus will all drain into your nasal cavity. The maxilla, you come back to the maxillary bone and look at it again. The opening to the maxillary sinus is actually superiorly located. You probably have no awareness of this being below the opening to come out into your nasal cavity unless you body surf or you surf and you get smashed in the wave and water gets shoved up your nose. And you come out on the beach and you turn your head down and water comes out. But you still feel this real great pressure in this area. The only way that you get that water out is to stand on your head so that now the opening from your maxillary sinus is dependent and the water will come on out. So you really literally have to stand on your head to get the water to get out of your maxillary sinus. If you haven't ever gotten tumbled by a wave, count your blessings. It's a very uncomfortable feeling. So here's your maxillary sinus. Here's the opening up here. The cilia there are beating the mucus upwards. So the mucus is actually being moved towards the opening and out into your nasal cavity. But when you get water in there and you get sand in there, the cilia aren't going to be able to move that. Here you see the inferior nasal concha attached to the maxillary bone. You don't see its attachment to the ethmoid bone or the palatine bone. You have to look at where the planar section was taken. It's taken too far in front for those bones to show up. You see the air cells in the ethmoid bone. You see the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone, superior and in, middle nasal concha. You also see the orientation of the bones in the orbit. So mostly zygomatic lateral, frontal, maxillary, inferior, medial, ethmoid bone. But you're in front of the sphenoid, so it doesn't show up. And you're not, you're also too far back for the palatine bone to show up. Crista galli, part of the ethmoid bone. Perpendicular plate, top part of your nasal septum. Base of the nasal septum, that unpaired bone called the vomer. Okay. So put everything back together. We've got perpendicular plate and vomer forming the bony part of your nasal septum. Front part will be cartilage. So you reach back there, you can move your nasal septum from side to side. That's the cartilage part. And then behind, that's the bony part. The part that glasses sit on, for the most part, is your true nasal bone. And the part that you of your nose that can bend back and forth, again, cartilage. So, ramus of the mandible, angle of the mandible, out in front will be the mental region, and the rest just kind of fill it in by calling it the body. So pterygoid processes of the sphenoid bone, the sphenoidal air sinus, cella turcica, lesser wing. You should try and identify everything or actually go and draw everything for yourself. I found that drawing it was better than just pointing to it, because then I physically had to orient the structures together on a blank piece of paper, and I learned it better than making flashcards or, you know, covering up the labels and trying to identify. I found that for me was more passive, and I didn't learn as well. Okay, so mandible. We've got the angle of the mandible, inside, outside, body of the mandible, the mental protuberance, mental foramen. We have also a foramen on the inside, just called the mandibular foramen, and nerves will enter there and then go to the teeth. Don't have to worry about them until we get to the nervous system. The condylar process, remember, condyle is an articular surface, round and smooth. This is going to form your part of your temporal mandibular joint or your jaw joint. So this is your mandibular process. It's got a nice roundish head on it. And we've got another process that looks like the beak of a bird. So they call it a coronoid process. Coronoid means in the shape of either a crow's beak or a raven's beak, I forget which. But it's a bird beak shape for that process. That process is going to be the attachment for your one of your muscles of mastication. This broad temporalis comes down and inserts there. And then the other major muscle of mastication that's superficial will attach to the angle and the body of your jaw, And then two more muscles of mastication will attach to your pterygoid processes. So when you're opening and closing your jaw, its hinge is here. This is one muscle of mastication. The other muscle will be attached out here. And then the others will be attached inside. Okay, so palatine process and then palatine bone. Do you have a palatine process of the maxilla? Do you have a maxillary process of the palatine bone? Yes. So there's a maxillary process of the palatine bone there. And then the palatine bone will head up and form the lateral walls of your nasal septum. The paranasal sinuses, they're there for the production of mucus that then helps trap particles from the air that you inhale. They also serve as part of your resonance of your voice. You probably all had an experience where you get a head cold and you sound different to you. But you call up your friend and you say, they say hello, and you start to talk to them on the phone and they say, oh, you got a cold. They can pick it up right away that the resonance in your voice has changed because of excessive accumulation of mucus in your paranasal sinuses. So the frontal ethmoidsphenoid maxillary sinuses, when the doctor examines you, he takes his little pen light and he shines it, trying to see, is there more mucus or can the light actually penetrate into these nasal sinuses? And if it doesn't, then he knows that there's an infection, probably an infection there. So resonance for your voice, it also takes some of the weight away from your head, so not solid bone, your head, your skull weighs less. It produces a lot of mucus for trapping particles, so cleansing of the air. The hyoid bone is a weird looking bone. It's got horny structures projecting off of a body. We've got smaller little horny projections, larger horny projections, simply called greater and lesser horns. And then the rest is the body of the hyoid. So unpaired bones in your skull, got the vomer in your nasal cavity, and hyoid that is anchoring your bones. Anchoring your tongue and also attached to neck muscles. The fetal skull has to continue growing. So it's got a lot of cartilage that will continue to proliferate. And as it does so, it is making the skull larger. And then you got ossification working from the edges in that will increase the size of the individual bony plates. So metopic suture early on, big cartilage plate there. A large cartilage fountain, they call it a fontanelle, anteriorly and posteriorly. So posterior fontanelle here, anterior fontanelle there. And then two fontanelles up by the sphenoid bone and two back by the mastoid process, so-called mastoid fontanelle and sphenoidal fontanelle. If any of these fountains cease to produce cartilage, then the bones will fuse and you're left with the skull having to expand not in the normal proportional direction, but in whatever direction it's left to expand. If all of them fuse too early, then the brain would probably herniate down through the foramen magnum, and that would put pressure on the brainstem, and you'd probably end up dying from that. But if the skull can still expand somewhere in some other direction, then you usually get very abnormal looking skulls. So when I saw Indiana Jones, the crystal skull, you saw that? And you saw these extraterrestrial skulls made out of crystal that were elongated in the back and had normal facial features in the front. All that would have to happen is that the frontal sphenoidal sinus and anterior fontanelles cease to produce cartilage, and the posterior and the mastoid fontanelles continue, and then the skull would elongate backwards. So I don't buy that extraterrestrial stuff. It can be very easily explained by premature fusion of these sutural plates. Okay, so just that was just my point. But you might see there's an actor, I don't know what his name is, but I've seen him in some current shows, and he's got a very prominent forehead. This kind of seems like it's projected out in front. What happens there is you get early fusion of the posterior fontanelles. So the frontal area is the only place the brain can, the skull continues to expand. So you get this predominant enlargement in the front. To correct this, you could do it surgically, but you're going to have to go in there and you're going to have to break bones, and that means that you could damage the brain. You've got to break bones, reposition bones, and then get them to fuse. What a traumatic surgery. It's all cosmetic. There's nothing wrong with that actor's brain. It's just his skull is a little different shape. But nevertheless, they do surgery on these kids because I guess the parents don't want them to be traumatized by, you know, snippy little friends who say, oh, you've got a bulgy forehead or something like that. You know, kids can be really nasty, but instead should teach the kid to fight backwards and say, I have frontal bossing, but my brain is perfectly normal. In fact, I probably have a better brain than you because I know I shouldn't be so inconsiderate to people who have structural abnormalities. You teach him to talk like that to kids, the other kids would probably shut up and back off. Okay, so we'll talk about vertebral column on Wednesday, and then probably looks like we'll get to some